Welcome to A Father's Heart with Dr. Phil Godeau, Dr. Brenda Godeau. We are a family-friendly church that teaches the Word of God so you can live an effective Christ-centered life. This is where the Word works when you work the Word.
We've been teaching the last few weeks on the area of fighting to keep strife out of your life. Say that. Fighting to keep strife out of your life. Now, you know, I've been pastoring for 36 years, and I just really thank God. Thank you. I've been pastoring for 36 years. I've taught a lot of messages in 36 years and before then, too. But this is one of those messages that I just am sort of overwhelmed with. I've taught a lot, but I'm sort of overwhelmed with this message because of the contents and the manifestation what God is doing through this message. And I try to tell y'all that whenever you try to teach on a message, that you got to understand how the enemy is going to try to fight against you. You got to understand you got to fight against strife yourself. Amen. Say amen.
Amen.
So even this morning, I came in this morning, and it's amazing to me that, again, some kind of strife broke out before I could even get in the service this morning. I try to tell people, you got to understand the enemy is going to bring and give you an opportunity to get into strife some kind of way. But if you understand the ramifications of it, then you will then do all you can to run like heck.
Amen.
Amen. To run like nobody's business. So we've been teaching on the area of strife. And so, and they got to fight to keep it out because it's an ongoing battle. It's not something that you're going to do just while you're here during the season that I'm teaching on it, but it's something that you're going to do for the rest of your life. Because see, most Christians, and I really am very convinced of this, have no clue of the ramifications of strife and the destructiveness that it brings into your life and every area of your life. And because we don't understand it, we don't fight against it. We don't have a recognition of being able to be recognized when it shows up and to be able to get it out of our life as quick as possible. So,
So we believe that the Lord interrupted the series that we were going through to bring this subject here. We know that it was God because this is the year of Jubilee,
release and favor.
And God wants to do these kind of things. He wants to release his favor and Jubilee and increase in your life, but we have to get this out of our lives. So he interrupted it because he loves you so much that he wants to bring this word before you because he knows if you allow strife in your life, it's going to kill your faith. It's going to kill your relationships.
Come on,
it's going to kill your families.
Come on.
It's going to kill your communities and your agreement. You know, where two or three touch and agree on anything, it shall be done. But when you're in strife, the two or three can't agree.
Right.
So he's in there to destroy. So God loves you too much to let you continue on without being reminded of the enemy's big weapon that he's trying to use to get God's people. Trying to get God's people, whose favor is on their life, if they allow God to be God of their life, he's trying to keep you from your blessings through the area of strife, but not in this church.
Not in this church. I declare that we're in a strife-free zone.
Amen.
I declare that your family is a strife-free zone. Your business is a strife-free zone. Come on, receive that in Jesus' name. See, if you don't declare it and you don't do it, then the enemy is going to get away with some stuff he should have never got away with. Because he's going to challenge you because he's going to try to bring some conflict.
Yeah.
He's going to try to bring some challenges into your life to be able to stop you from being able to experience God's best for your life. When I think about all the years I've been 36 years teaching on faith, and faith, is what pleases God.
Exactly.
God is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And when he can counteract or negate your faith, negate God's ability to work in your life, you got to fight like nobody's business to keep strife out of your life. Yeah. You can be a good Christian, love Jesus, love Jesus, be faithful, but still are never getting the blessings and the things that God wants in your life because of strife is contention, it's conflict. It goes on and on of all the different things I put down. It's arguments, it's, you know, it's disagreements and quarreling and rivalry, different things that the enemy uses to generate strife. You know, you can be the one that is the victim of strife and then become a double victim because you got into strife with the one that hurt you.
You could be right. You could be right. But it depends on how you handle it. When you standing on it, you just got to learn how to stand right and do right. But when you're right and you're just still going to go at somebody, now you're stepping out of your place with God and you're opening the door to strife, even though you're right, but you did it, you handled it the wrong way.
And so they could be wrong as they can be, but because you got into strife with them trying to prove your point. Because what is strife? Strife is nothing but dealing with your own selfish ambitions or trying to prove yourself right. You know, but somebody who is mature, developed, will be able to back down and allow the person, even though they're wrong, to be able to go ahead and apologize and just keep moving on because you understand the ramifications of what strife would do, even though you were the victim of strife or the victim of a situation. You know, strife is selfishness. It's always trying to have it my way. And therefore, the contentions come in, the things happen. Here they are, both of them, one could have backed down and allowed, and they both could have got what they wanted. But because they were neither one of them willing to back down, they both ended up in disaster and calamity in their life. Isn't it something? I wonder how many are watching by television or the internet that have lost things in your life that you shouldn't have never lost, but you lost it because you were not willing to back down. You weren't willing to humble yourself, and you wanted to be right, or you wanted to press the point in, and then you still lost more than you can imagine. So the enemy works really hard to keep us from being able to get all the things that God has for us.
You see how mean they looked at each other, how ugly strife makes you when you're just angry. Then they lost control. So here are this bear and what, a moose, the big old animals, and here come these little bitty raccoon and rabbit. Yeah. Here they come, small, but because they're so out of control and so angry, where envy and strife is, there's confusion and every evil work. They're just so out of control that here they are hurting the little ones that come. That couldn't hurt them at all, but because they were totally out of control, the little one got back at them.
See, what strife does is strife, it doesn't just hurt you. They both lost everything, but then they hurt others.
Yeah.
And they can be smaller, like your children. Mm-hmm. And sometimes strife, it just takes a generational. It goes through a generation. Right. It starts off and it just keeps going because nobody checked it at all.
Right.
And when strife comes, again, poverty comes, lack, sickness and disease, different calamities and destruction and confusion and deception and all these evil works, because strife really is Satan's mass of destruction. It is a weapon of mass destruction. Strife is a weapon of mass destruction. And it destroys more than you could ever imagine. And therefore, you love people that you get walk away from, churches, your business, your job, things that bring so much loss because it is a weapon of mass destruction. It stammers. It stammers your faith, your productivity. It stammers your assignment for God, your purpose for God. It just stops so much from God being able to do in your life when you get into strife. I'm telling you, when strife shows up, get the hell out of there. Run like nobody's business. Because it's going to kill, steal, and destroy everything good in your life. And you find out when people get into strife, they get into conflicts, they get into all kind of things that just causes all those other ones around them to be affected.
Everybody to suffer behind yes. it. Amen.
So in Matthew, the 12th chapter, Matthew 12 and 25, and Jesus, it says, and Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom, what?
Divided.
Come on, everybody. Jesus, in Matthew 12, 25, and Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom, what?
Divided.
Against its what?
Itself.
Itself was brought to desolation, and every city, how many cities?
Every city.
Or every house divided against itself shall not stand. Mm-hmm. Y'all believe that?
Yes.
Turn to your neighbor and tell him, you better get this or I'm going to have to try to preach it to you. Tell him, you better get this or I'm going to have to preach it to you. If it's divided, the spirit of division, when strife comes in, it brings a spirit of confusion. It brings a spirit of deception. It brings a spirit of division and then destruction. The enemy is working very hard to try to keep you out of the blessings that God has for you. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
No.
Okay, give me an amplified translation for it, please. Go ahead, Bren.
And Jesus, and knowing their thoughts, he said to them, any kingdom that is divided against itself is being brought to desolation and laid waste. And no city or house divided against itself will last or continue to stand.
Wow.
But I like the part where he says he's knowing their thoughts. And in the other scripture it said, and Jesus knew their thoughts. Because every bit of strife starts with a thought. Before you do anything, before you fight against anybody, before you combat anybody, before you go against anybody, it starts with you thinking about it. But Jesus knew their thought. Pastor and I don't necessarily know your thoughts, but Jesus knew their thoughts, and he knows our thoughts. And we got to recognize through the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is your helper. He's your paraclete. He's the long side to help you and aid you. And he will remind you of your thoughts, because he'll most of the time tell you to be quiet. He'll tell you to walk away from the situation. He'll give you some kind of warning what you need to do before you actually act. So he knew their thoughts. So that's where you want to check yourself out, knowing their thoughts. And no kingdom, any kingdom. You know, me and Pastor.
Or business, or family, relationship, whatever right. it is. Go ahead.
If it's divided against itself, it's not going to be able to stand.
Right.
And so when it says any kingdom, like Pastor and I are on what we call the cruise ship now. We've been through the courtship, we've been through the battleship. But after 43 years, praise the Lord, we're on the cruise ship. So this is not an area. Several years ago, we could have been divided against, and the enemy was able to get in. So he's not able to get in this way, but he may come in another way. So you have to, so any kingdom, anything that God has established, anything God is trying to do, the enemy will try to come in and destroy. Just because you got some things working fine, thank God for those. But watch out for those little sneaky areas that the enemy tries to sliver his way in to bring division.
So what happens is so it says here, if any kingdom is divided against itself, it is brought to desolation.
Yeah.
See, and this is what the enemy is doing in so many Christians' lives who love God, but not getting prayers answered, not seeing the greatness of God manifest on their behalf because of the spirit of strife. Yes, you were hurt. Yes, they did you wrong. Yes, that shouldn't have happened. Yes, I don't even understand how it could happen. But I got to make sure that I maintain and keep myself out of strife, because desolation is the next thing in my life if I don't deal with this here, or being laid to waste. And that's why he says, and then he didn't say this, every kingdom, any city. What is the biggest thing that we're dealing with in our country right now is a spirit of strife.
Yes, we are.
Our country is on the verge of civil war if something doesn't change. Our country, we got politics going on. Politics is nothing but strife. Strife is everywhere right now. And that's why maybe even more so God is getting us to deal with it, because racial divide, all the different things the enemy is doing to try to bring strife. And we got to fight against it. Come on, turn your neighbor and tell him we got to fight against
it. We've got to fight against it.
Turn him around, come on, shout him and say, we got to fight against it. Listen to me, if you're not fighting, you're giving place to it. Because it's gonna run rampant, it's gonna happen. The enemy is, this is his favorite weapon to keep you, because it negates every good thing in your life. Listen to me, it negates every good thing that God wants to do in your life, and it opens the door for every negative thing that the devil wants to do in your life. Well, y'all didn't even get that. You didn't even get it. It negates every good thing that God wants to do in your life. How can I love God and serve God and do this and still don't have these manifestations? I'm believing for this and this and that. Because strife is negating every good thing that God wants to do in your life, and it opens the door for every negative thing that the devil wants to do in your life. So strife opens the door to temptations. How many of y'all have ever had some real challenges with temptations in here? Would you raise your hand up? Okay, I got both mine up, so you better raise your hands up right now. Amen. With temptation. Temptations is no joke. The enemy uses temptation to allure you. It is a bait that he uses to get you into strife. So you got to fight to stay out of strife by being able to keep the door closed. But if you open the door, then it gives the devil the right to bring every evil temptation into your life. And there's some temptations some of y'all should have never had to go through. But because of strife, because of contention, because of conflict, and you didn't know how to back out of it and do right, you wasn't like the little raccoon. You see his eyes sort of open up, and he's sort of like, you know, we're getting ready to get into strife. Could you see it in his eyes? And then he just decided, I'm not going to get into it. And he went on and bowed down and let the rabbit jump over him. You know, sometimes you just might have to let somebody just go on and jump over you. But see, you still win because you still get to go where you're going. And you're not going to be hindered or blocked in that area. Or you can get up there and get in contention. So look with me and go back into this verse. I just want to bring out one more thing here. So go to verse 26. Verse 26. Then I want to read it in another translation. Verse 26. Verse 26. Okay, let me just read it out the Bible here. Verse 26 says, and it says, and if Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How shall then this kingdom stand? If Satan can't even stand, strife can even destroy his kingdom. Strife is such a powerful weapon of the enemy that it even would destroy his own kingdom. So if Satan can't handle it, you sure can't handle it in your life. So we got to ask, come on, get your hands up real quickly and say, Father, help me. Because I need a lot of help. And I need it right now. To discern. Strive. When it comes. Need it.
Basically, when you open the door to strife, that's when the temptations come, like we were talking about. We open the door to strife. Now, all other kind of thoughts come into your mind. How many know when you get upset with somebody? And as long as you're fine with them, but as soon as you get into strife, now you're thinking about, and you did that last week.
See, there you go.
And then you, yeah, and
exactly.
You know, now you're tempted to go and, you know, right. start pulling up. And I didn't like the way you did this, and I didn't like
right.
So all kind of things start opening up after you enter strife.
Once the door got open, well, come on, y'all know what she's talking about. Once you start getting into some contention or conflict, come on, I'm gonna talk to the side. Oh, y'all ain't paying attention. Y'all with me over here? What happened? The enemy starts flooding your mind with all kind of other negative things about them, something you ain't even thought about until you got into the conflict. Well, why is he doing that? Because he's trying to get you deeper into the ditch that you can't get out of. You know, they used to say, if you want to get out of a ditch, quit digging. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, quit digging now. Got to quit digging now. So that's what it does. He floods your mind. Why? He's using that to be able to get you deeper into that offense.
So now you're tempted to do things right. that you never thought. Just like when the little illustration for them to be in strife, and then you pick on those little critters.
Well, you really felt sorry for them, didn't you?
I really felt bad. You know, right. I mean, just to pounce them and throw them and kick them and different things on that line. But they wouldn't have done that in themselves. They would saw them as little critters.
They was in conflict. Well, the issue is that this happens to kids every day.
Yeah. Wow.
In divorces.
Yeah.
Breakups.
Yeah.
Families seeing their mother and father fight and mm-hmm. argue. Mm-hmm. It affects them. They might as well go over there and beat them upside the head.
Wow.
It happens every day, and this is why we got so much problem today in our society, because our children have been affected, and they're carrying this angry, conflicting spirit and going out and these gangs and doing all kind of stuff, crazy, the drug problems.
And they're angry, copying the same thing they see at home. They're
and that's why our juvenile system is overflowing with kids. Our criminal justice system is overflowing because nobody has ever dealt with strife.
We got to deal with it in the house of God. We got to get it cleared out. The scripture said they will know we're Christians by our love. So there's something that we've got to let love conquer this spirit that is trying to come in and destroy God's people.
Go back to Matthew, the 25th chapter, and give me the Living or the Message Bible on that, if you can, please. This is why the enemy works so hard to be able to try to deal with us, to try to get us into it. People leave churches out of strife. See, you can't get into strife and then leave and stay in strife and think you're going to be better.
Right.
You can't leave a relationship out of strife
right.
and think that you're going to find somebody that's going to be better because you're taking it with you. Yes. I've had people come to church and say, I'm so glad to be here at Calvary Christian Center, and I've heard about you, Pastor Godot, and you're the kind of pastor I'm looking for, because that pastor I came from, he wasn't this, and he wasn't that, and this and that. And I said, well, and we don't want you here either. We don't want you here because you're full of strife, and you're going to cause an infection to come in here. You're carrying the spirit of Ebola or something with you. Amen. We got to quarantine you. Got to get you out of here and get you delivered. Come on, y'all. I talked about one time. I said, one time I'm gonna do it this year. I'm gonna put a wedding dress on, and I'm gonna play the song dun 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 dun, and I'm gonna walk in with my wedding dress on, carrying a lot of luggage and dragging some. Oh yeah, it would be all over the internet. But my point is, if you get married and you don't go through the right channels and do the right thing and get some stuff cleaned, get them closets cleaned out, you're marrying somebody who's dressed up, but they're carrying a lot of luggage. They got junk in their trunk. Look what it says. And Jesus knew their thoughts and replied, any kingdom divided by civil war or is what? Doom. A town or a family, what?
Splintered.
By fueling will fall apart. will fall apart. And that's the weapon of the enemy. Give me the Message Bible real quickly. Message. And it says, Jesus what?
Confronted
their what?
Slander.
Their slander. You need to underline it or write it in the slander. He says, a what?
Judge.
Who gives what?
Opposite verdicts.
Opposite verdicts on the same person. What?
Cancels himself.
He cancels himself out. A family that is in a what?
Constant squabble.
What? Squabbling is what?
Disintegrates.
Disintegrates. Just starts disintegrating. Some of y'all in here today, and you're watching by television or internet, you have been the victim of strife. And the reason why some things have never got together in your life, and you know God is good. You know God is a big God. And you know that God can do more than what he's doing in your life, but he cannot because of the spirit of strife. Has never been addressed. But I'm declaring today to every one of you, you're not going to leave here the same way you came. I'm declaring today that it's an end. We're drawing a line in the sand, and we're saying it's an end to strife and division in this house. This is a strife-free zone here. And in your family and in your career and whatever area. Come on, talk to me. In the name of Jesus. You're not going to leave out of here and allow the enemy to continue to plunder your life. You're going to get rid of your pride and your selfish ambition. And you're going to be willing to recognize and do get away from and move away from strife when it shows up. Say amen.
And then make sure you're not the one bringing it. I'm telling you to run away from it, but you know, if you run away and you're the one stirring it up, you know, it's gonna start up again. This fire gonna start up. You know, I was singing an earlier service. I had great parents, but I remember it was like my parents, not my mother's side, my daddy's side.
Oh, now you're going to define it this morning. This morning just, you didn't define it. You said your family.
And I never knew my mother's
a great revelation.
Mother, I never knew their grandparents. So I'm bringing it from my father because I got to know my grandmother. But they were just around a lot of gossip, and they were murmuring all the time and always complaining, and it looked like they weren't
contentious.
A lot of contention in the family. I just kept stuff, and it's like, what I can remember is like they weren't happy, it didn't seem like, unless they were stirring up something, like keeping mess going. And it's really sad to me to think about, even though they're gone, I still remember them, unfortunately, for the quarrels, for the arguments, for the contention. And I just don't want that to be named among us as God's people. When we leave here, we want to leave with a different kind of testimony that we weren't the ones bringing strife. We weren't the ones bringing contention and confusion and all kind of mayhem.
So off that point, listen to this. Strife will outlive your burial. In other words, when you are dead and gone, the spirit of strife is still working off of what you did. Strife is still, you will be labeled of a strife bearer.
Good people, but they kept strife going. God fearing, but they kept strife going. It don't mix good. That is not the testimony you want.
Absolutely. So look with me in Proverbs 16 chapter. Proverbs 16, Proverbs 16 and verse 28, Proverbs 16, 28. And it says, a forward man. What kind of man?
Forward.
I'm talking to everybody. What kind of man?
Forward.
Okay, let me just ask a question. Stay with me right here. What is a forward man? I want you to tell me. Shout it out to me. What is a forward man? A what? Say anything that come to their mind?
Yeah.
Okay. What's a
aggressive
forward man? A what?
Perverse.
A perverse man?
Yeah.
Okay, you got that out your thing here. Okay, okay. What is a forward man? A what? I can't hear you.
Unafraid.
Unafraid. Say what he want to say. What is a forward man?
A controlling man.
A controlling man. What is a forward? Come on, I'm asking you a question. What is a forward man? Because we need to understand, because the Bible says a forward man soweth strife. If a forward man soweth strife, then we better know what a forward man is. Or what about a forward woman? Oh, y'all got quiet on that one, huh? Huh? Can there be such a thing as a forward woman?
Yes, Lord. Help us, Jesus.
Come on, I need a little more. Yes, that's it. So we could put in there a forward man or woman, soweth strife. Somebody who's full of pride, somebody who is selfish, somebody to feel like that they just got to win every situation. Come on, is a forward man or a woman. Am I right? So a forward man is one that soweth strife, or a woman. Then it says, and a whisperer does what?
Separates
chief friends or close friends. Whisperer. Well, what is a whisperer? Oh, y'all know that one, huh? Y'all know what that one is. A gossiper. Come on, get your hand up and say, God, help me not to gossip another day in my life. Help me not to gossip another day in my life. You know when somebody brings gossip to you, they see you as a dumpster, a garbage dump. They don't even respect you when they bring garbage to you. They're just dumping some garbage in you. I this morning I came into service and one of my guys came up to me and tried to start telling me something that happened this morning. I said, you are disrespecting me. You do not come and talk to me and tell me nothing about anything right now. I'm focused, my anointing is to get this word out, and you are being used by the enemy to try to distract me. To bring me some gossip. Amen. So we got to understand that a forward man or woman does what? Soweth strife. You know what they always used to say? A whisper or somebody who is a gossiper? Listen to me. They are no different from what we just talked in the beginning. Because gossip soweth strife. You know what the Bible says? God hates.
Right.
He hates
six
what?
Six things he hates, but one is he hates them that sow discord, among the brethren.
Give me the Amplified or the Living or the Message on that. And it says, a troublemaker starts fights. Gossips break up friendships. How many of y'all ever had somebody gossip on you? Anybody ever had gossip on you? Oh, God. I believe I've been the chief of gossip, where people gossip about me. I don't even look on Facebook or Instagram or some of that kind of stuff, because people got voices they shouldn't have never had. And they just say anything that they want to say, and I'm not going to allow somebody's stupidity to poison me for what God wants to do. Because you know you can watch, listen to, read some of that stuff, and get the spirit of God, strife inside of you. I'm talking to y'all. Some of y'all in here today, you are there where you are right now because you allow with somebody that should never had a voice in your life to say something that you read or somebody told you, and you got into strife. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, I'm praying for your deliverance right now in Jesus' name.
And you gotta be careful. Who's bringing you something? People will bring you things, and like Pastor said, the person that maybe this morning that brought him something, they probably didn't mean anything. So it's up to us to straighten them out. You know, I'm guarding my heart. I'm not gonna let you dump something in me. It's the way you just share with them, because we're helping each other. The reason I didn't want to look like I was throwing my grandmother, my father under the bus. I only brought that up to say that sometimes people will do things and they don't even recognize what they're doing.
Exactly. They don't even know it.
They don't even know that they're doing it. And then when I pick up sometimes some of my daddy's ways trying to show up in my relationship with my husband. I saw some things trying to show up, and I was like, ooh, I can't.
Wait a minute now. Wait a minute. Now you done brought me into this thing.
Right, but
I didn't do that in the 7:30 and the 9:30 service.
Right, it just came to me. But you know, it's a good thing. See, when you can recognize you don't want to be like somebody else or some of their ways, because I'm telling you, when you're around people, you can pick up things. You can be around strife, and you weren't even in strife. And
okay,
now,
I got you. I got you.
Yeah, so don't take it personal. I ain't.
Yeah. Okay, I got you. Okay.
Got me.
So you saw some of your daddy in me.
Of me picking up some of the strife that I could have brought into our relationship, but I caught it. I recognized it was my daddy kind of trying to speak through me, not me. But it was something I picked up.
Wow.
And I had to recognize it.
Wow.
Some of y'all have things in around people that have affected you. So you recognize it and you don't like it and you deal with it.
Wow. Come on, y'all. Wow. Well, that was at least several fights that we had that we didn't have to have. Amen. Praise God. Glory to God. Huh? Huh? Wow, look at that. You saw what the spirit of your daddy trying to come on you.
Right, but I recognize some of your folk coming out of you too.
Oh.
So we help each other. Time we don't mean it.
Oh, I worship you, Lord God. I just worship you right now. Yep, I refuse to respond in Jesus' name. Okay.
You're a product of what you're around, so you want to surround yourself with the Spirit of God.
Okay, real quickly, put the scripture back up on the screen for me. And it says, a gossip breaks up friendships. Give me another translation. Because what happens is a lot of relationship that you have shouldn't have never been broke up with some people. God put it together, but because of your own ignorance or your own stupidity, the enemy was able to come in there and divide you out of a relationship that God put you into. Or it could be a church, it could be a job, different things along that line. You say a troublemaker plants seeds of strife. Gossip, what? Separates the best of friends. Say, not in my house.
Not in my house.
Say, not in my life.
Not in my life.
Don't some of y'all wish you would have got this here about 30 years ago? How many of y'all know that you would be a lot further ahead than if you are right now, but you didn't get it earlier? There's a lot of things, absolutely, hear me now, it should never, ever happen in your life. It should have never, ever happened in your life. But it did because you didn't understand and because it wasn't taught. And therefore, your faith was negated. Your agreement was negated, God's power was negated, and therefore you have no favor or blessings upon your life. What scripture was that I did this morning on with the favor in it? Was that the 25th?
Matthew, no.
Huh?
No. That's Matthew 5:9.
Okay.
The peace scripture.
Okay, yeah, okay, go with me. Go to Matthew 5:9. Look what it says. Mm-hmm. Blessed. What did it say?
Blessed.
Now, this right there, this is the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes is dealing with the area that Jesus is dealing with, the different things that...
Different attitudes you need to have is to be blessed.
Right, right. So it says, blessed are the peacemakers. Mm-hmm. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the what?
Children of God.
Do I got any children of God in here today? Blessed. We got to be careful about raising your hand right now. Because you're going to have an opportunity to be a peacemaker. Look what it says. Give me the Amplified Bible. Give me the Amplified. Look what it says. Go ahead, Brenda.
Blessed, enjoying enviable happiness.
Mm.
A blessed person enjoying enviable happiness, spiritually prosperous with life, joy, and satisfaction. In God's favor and salvation.
Wow.
Regardless of their outward condition.
Wow.
Are the makers and the maintainers of peace.
Lord have mercy. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. Now look what, put it back up there, and it says, "For they shall then be called the children of God." So go back up. So I want go back up. Look what it says here, and that they will be enjoying inevitable happiness, spiritual inevitable happiness, and prosperous with a life of joy and satisfaction in God's favor. Can I just tell you something right now? When God's favor comes on your life, everybody gonna know it's on your life. Hear me now. The only reason some things are not happening in your life is because you don't have favor in it. But when you start getting the favor of God, so what would the enemy want to do? Is to be able to negate the favor of God on your life, because when you got favor, things just start happening for you. Can I believe God for something today? Can I believe God that the favor is going to be restored on your life in Jesus' name? Come on, can I believe God that the favor of God is going to be restored upon your life? Why? Because we're going to get the strife out of our life. Look what it says here. And then it says, favor and salvation. Well, salvation is health, healing, deliverance, preservation, soundness, and safety, and prosperity. So God says here that you'll come into this place of satisfaction in God's favor and salvation. Every area of your life, God is going to bless it like nobody's been. People are going to be saying, man, look at your life. Look what got to be a God, because what he's doing on your behalf. And some of y'all, can I believe for something else? I'm asking y'all, can I believe for something else? Can I believe God for some of the things that have been stolen from you out of your ignorance? Out of your ignorance, that God can restore back some of those things back to you in Jesus' name? I'm asking you, can I believe with y'all? Watch this here. And he says, in favor, and regardless of their outward, what?
Conditions.
Regardless of your outward condition, because we walk by
faith
and not by
sight.
So we don't allow the outward conditions or circumstance or situation to dictate to us about how we feel or respond. No, the outward conditions might not be the best. Things are negative. Things are going contrary. But I'm not going to let it dictate to me to make me respond out of the will of God, or get me out of position where God was not able to bless my life the way he wants to. Blessed are the peacemakers, the makers of peace. See, you got to be a peacemaker. Come on, turn to your neighbor and say, you got to be a peacemaker. And you can never be a peacemaker as long as you're complaining about the outward condition. You'll never be a peacemaker if the conditions always dictate to what you say. We're going to talk a little bit more about your mouth another time. Flip Wilson said, loose lips sink ships. Oh, y'all remember that? Okay. It's an older crowd here. Amen. But anyway, but it says that, and it says, and regardless of their outward conditions, then it says, are the makers and the maintainers of peace. Turn to David and say, he's talking about me right now. Come on, shout at him. Tell him, he's talking about me right now. Now watch this here. You're going to get an opportunity to be able to be a maker of peace, but now you can't just make peace. You're going to have to do what? You're going to have to maintain some peace. That's why I said earlier, you're going to draw a line that today, the 28th of August, on this 28th of August, I'm going to be a maker and a maintainer of peace. Once I get peace to come in, once I refuse to allow myself to be baited and take the bait and bite the bait of strife and contention and discord. Once I refuse to take the bait, listen to me, I'm going to fight to maintain the peace, and I got to make the peace, then I got to fight to maintain it. And that fighting to maintain it is no joke. Push the neighbor and say, he's talking to you right now. Hey, you might can make the peace, you might can make it, but once you make it, you got to fight. You got to fight to maintain it. You got to fight to maintain it, because somebody is going to say something or something's going to happen to get you to try to bite the bait again to break the peace that you brought. Get you to bite to break the peace that you brought. You made the peace, and then now you broke the peace. Because you allowed yourself to be moved by the outward conditions of your situation or by what was said or done. But I'm going to say, not in this house. I'm going to say, not in your life. See, we're going to draw a line, because what the enemy is trying to do is get you not to draw a line. This line I'm not going to cross, never again. I am not going to allow the enemy to steal, kill, or destroy anything in my life anymore, because that's all this strife does. It kills, steals, and destroys. It works through the spirit of deception, confusion, division, and destruction and calamity to be able to take every good thing that you will not have a testimony of what God is doing in your life because of strife that you thought you was right in you. I'm going to grave with my, I'm right, but you right in you. This is wrong as two left feet. You're right, but you broke. You're right, but you sick. You're right, and you can't get no prayers answered. You're right, you can't get you another person in your life that want to be your friend. But you're right, but you're lonely. Come on, I'm talking to y'all right now. Sometimes it's just go ahead and bow down. Be the raccoon. Bow down. Let them go ahead and walk over you. Get on down the road. Get your hands up. Raise them up high. Say, Father,
Father.
Say it like you really mean it. Say, Father,
Father.
In the name of Jesus,
I declare my life
a strife-free zone.
I repudiate.
I come against
the
spirit of strife
from
having any place in my life.
Holy Spirit,
help me.
To discern
the sneakiness,
the
cleverness,
the
cunningness
of strife
when it tries to appear
or
manifest. Come on, say,
or manifest
in my life.
I need some help.
I need help right now.
I don't want it in my life.
I don't want to be
hindered anymore.
I want to live
a victorious
life,
a
life full of
favor
and salvation
manifesting
in every area of my
life.
I declare
it,
I decree it
in
the name of Jesus.
So
I humble myself
under the
hand of Almighty
God,
and
I resist
strife.
Get
out of my life.
Go
now.
Go
now.
In the name of
Jesus.
And
Lord Jesus,
forgive me.
Come on,
Lord Jesus,
forgive
me
for allowing
strife
in my
life,
in
the name of Jesus.
Now shout about it.
Come on,
shout about it in Jesus'
name.
No, what
they did was wrong.
What they did was wrong.
What they did
was wrong.
But
don't you make it
a double wrong.
Don't you
allow the devil to
get in there and give
another opportunity
to kill, steal,
and destroy your
life.
Jesus
died on the
cross to
pay the price
that you would not
have to live under the
curse.
And
the curse is running
rampant in the body
of Christ
because of the spirit of
strife.
But not
in this house no more.
Come on,
say it.
Not
in this house,
not in my life.
Now
some of you
that have been struggling
with answer prayers,
today is your
promotion day
today.
Today is your day of elevation today. Things that have been will not be like it was no more. Come on. It will not be like it was no more because God is elevating you today to break the power of the enemy, but you got to see it today. I confess, I ask for God to forgive me, and now you got to walk away from it when it brings its ugly head back up again. I'm going to be a fighter to fight to make and maintain peace. Say it. If you don't, you're going to go to your grave being remembered for the person you didn't want to be remembered for. And you're going to go earlier than you should have went. And your children and family members are going to suffer behind your stupidity. But not in this house. Not in my life. Come on, not in my life, not in this house, in Jesus' name. No, we call an end to strife and confusion and division and calamity and every other evil work. You're out here now. Therefore, get your hands up. Father, thank you for healing those that have been believing for healing. Healing those that have been believing for healing. Delivering those because the Spirit of the Lord is in this house right now to heal the brokenhearted. To set the captives free. To open up the blinded eyes. We declare it's in this house right now. That burden moving, yoke destroying, power of God is here now. You will never, from this day forth, ever be the same again in Jesus' name. Now say amen, 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 amen. Now that you've heard the word, I want you to accept Christ in your life. It's the greatest thing that can happen for you. So say this right now. Say, Lord Jesus, I open the door to my heart and receive you as my Lord and Savior. Now, if you did that, he's in your life. Thank God you have to do nothing else but just open your heart. If you did that, I'm in agreement with you. Write us, call us, email us, text us, or go on at Philip Godot, either Twitter or Facebook, and we are being back in contact with you. Love you, praying for you, move forth in your life.
I have just heard so many wonderful testimonies about people who have just been blessed, where they've heard a word or they've received a word from pastor, and they're at home and they realize they want to give into that word and they're able to do that. So 24/7, you're able to access our giving portal. There are three specific ways. Text to give is the most simple, fastest, convenient way. You can also do it online at CalvaryChristianCenter.com and just click on the Donate Now button, and it will take you to the exact same page. All of our digital portal looks the same, so you're not confused. You're not getting a different page. You get the same page every time because it's really safe. It's simple. It's fast. It's secure. It's convenient. And then the third way is to access the digital giving page through Calvary Christian Center app. Just type in Calvary Christian Center into your app store search bar. Scroll down until you see our familiar icon. Click on it. It will download it for free. And the great thing about it is very, very soon, the prestigious Dr. Godot is going to be have even more availability of messages through our app. So that's another incentive for you to get the app, because we're going to be connected to some podcast messages, and you're going to know, right, you're going to be the first to know if you have the app on your phone.